Hello everyone, welcome back, and this is the last session of this day. It's about academic work, about decarbonization, and I think it was a very interesting conversation before about decarbonization in islands, and here we can see what the science believes and how science goes to have this energy transition. And I would like to welcome the first presenter, Mrs. Katerini Gika. It's a work written by Katerini Gika, Stratios Zacharis, Dimitrios Kikos, Dimitrios Lavour. And its title is Climate Change Adaptation, Measures and Strategies for Electric Grid Resilience Enhancement, Impact Assessment and Lessons Learned from the Recent Extreme Weather Event, Media. Welcome, Ms. Gika. The floor is yours.
Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm an electrical engineer in the Occupational Health and Safety Department of the Hellenic Electricity Distribution Network Operator. And today we are going to discuss
I think we have a problem with the connection of Mrs. Gika. Please, can the menu can help me? We have to wait for the reconnection, or we can go on with the next presentation and come back to Mrs. Gika. Okay, I think we can go on with Mr. Achilleas Kanellopoulos. Mr. Achilleas Kanellopoulos is the writer and the presenter of the work titled Geothermal Hybrid Production Using Deep Drilling for Electricity and Rig Hydrogen Production. Welcome, Mr. Kanellopoulos.
Good evening, Mr. Chikaru. Good evening, and I want to say that a little bit about myself. I'm a mining engineer and have a PhD degree from South Africa in rock mechanics. So, therefore, the geothermal application, which represents an innovation for renewable energy, is a combination from the two ends. First, we use geothermal energy by deep drilling. And second, the surplus of the energy, we want to store it via liquid nitrogen. This, trying to make the connection with the previous session, I propose in this particular paper five islands to apply that, to become 100% carbon free. And these are for the islands which present, according to the IGME research, we talk about Santorini, Milos, Nisiros, Kos, and Chios. Later on, we're going to see that we do a stronger version of this method for northeastern Greece. We had done a case study for Thera, Santorini, which is a very important island for the Greek tourism, applying drip drilling. And we know that in drilling, since I belong to the School of Rock Mechanics of South Africa, every 100 meters, the temperature of the crust is increasing by what we call thermal gradient, which is about 30 degrees centigrade. Therefore, like in South Africa, for instance, there is a well where at 3,000 kilometers, where the temperature is about 63 degrees. So I want to make you familiar with the geothermal energy. Using high entropy geothermal energy, that means temperatures very high, we can see here in this slide just a schematic presentation how can pump hot energy using a twin well up to 10,000 kilometers. We circulate water and water comes up, and then we take that to make electricity, one part, and the other, we try to process it through PEM electrolysis to turn it, to store it, because the problem in all renewables is storage. So the second leg of my presentation is how can we store via electrolysis? So you can see here how it works. Now, this method, the way it appears, has been applied already. Of course, a lot of people have a lot of doubts about that because it's pretty new. The first geothermal application for electric energy has been presented in Iceland since 1930, but this was all for direct electricity production. The largest amount of about nearly 1,000 megawatts is presented in California, which California doesn't have any other sources of energy. There is a lot of work in Turkey running under testing now, and the first complete, the Mokai is the first complete factory which produces at the same time hybrid electricity as well as liquid nitrogen. In Afyon, Turkey, at this very moment, we have solved most of the problems of the geothermal energy, high enthalpy energy, and now we try to achieve better ways from energy efficiency point of view for the electricity leg as well as from the PEM electrolysis. This is called drip drilling, and drip drilling technologies have been taken from the deep drilling applications mainly in Mexico Gulf or offshore. I work as a consultant for a lot of deep drilling applications. So nowadays, definitely, we can really work out either for Santorini, 110 to 100 megawatts, or for Evros River, the three sedimentary areas, where can increase there the capacity, we can really work it out even to 1,000 megawatts. And there, we can do the same. Connect the electricity produced to the grid, or alternatively store it. And the third element, the hot water circulation can really serve agribusiness applications. So it's a three-win-win-win application. Now, definitely, in order to talk about the first leg, which is called deep drilling, next slide, please, we have the first side is the operation, drilling. Drilling is the area where technology, thanks to oil and gas, offshore drilling, now has achieved a lot of steps as far as cost is concerned, as well as efficiency. We talk about the most updated methods using NMR techniques, nuclear magnetic resonance and gamma rays, in order to have real-time characterization of the rock so can really drill fast, even 5, 6, or 10 kilometers. Gamma rays, at the other time, they identify the porosity of the rock, so we know what we're doing and we're ready to digitize this process. The next stage for continental Greece, this one, is to produce the turbines for electricity. We talk about the ship technology. We take the steam, hot steam involved, and we turn it to electricity. A part of that, 20-30%, is introduced to PEM electrolysis in order to take water and turn it to hydrogen. Hydrogen comes in gaseous form, and then we have to make it liquid, and then we store it, and then we can have to use it direct to distribute it. We can either put it even in pipelines, can use cars, buses, factories to use hydrogen. Recently in Sweden, they had a steel factory using hydrogen 2 weeks ago. So this enhanced twin geothermal applications can be very important for northeastern Greece. Alexandroupolis now is a hub for LNG importing from United States. Now we can pick up the three rivers in northeastern Greece, the river of Evros, the river of Nestos, and the river of Strymon, and build up three units. For practical reasons, we take one case study, Santorini, another case study, Evros. But this can multiply it by 5 in islands and by 3 in northeastern Greece. Definitely, the renewable energy based on geothermal sources is not new. The first effective application of geothermal energy, and we talk about Theodoros Siculus, who reports that, is from Thales 600 before Christ, where the city, in a whole city, had warm water using geothermal water. So this can be noted, and then, of course, the Romans also did a certain period were try to use the geothermal energy for spas, but again they have to pump hot water from Earth. The Institute of Geological and Mining Research, ICME, has done an enormous work since the 70s by test drilling, so they developed with a very systematic work a map in whole Greece, the island side, which I can see that a lot of people talk about Nisiros or Santorini or Milos or Lesbos, and by moving that, we can see the map ICME that the areas, this is a map of, drawn by the ICME engineers, the areas where we have indication of geothermal hot water, but of course most of the people talk with old technologies, 200 meters, we talk about new technologies, at least 5 to 10,000 meters. That means you can always have, with this methodology, not 60 or 70 degrees centigrade water, but water at temperatures higher than high enthalpy, we call it 200 degrees centigrade. This form of renewable energy has the benefits in comparison with the others that does not disturb the environment. Most of the factories are very nice. They don't have any, they don't disturb the environment. In contrast with the, particularly the Aeolian wind energy, which disturbs the beautiful setup aesthetically of Greek islands. For the Greek, northeastern Greece part, we have really to work out producing intensive low-cost energy, and this low-cost energy becomes today very important considering the high prices of natural gas, in order to become competitive in this area of Thrace or northeastern Greece. Now, case studies. Let's move to a case study. This is engineering method. Instead of talking about the old method, we try to do a case study. Geothermal hydrogen applications for the for Thera, for Santorini. In this case, we can really work out the funds which can given this one. In this slide, as you can see, Santorini can produce 100 megawatt hours for the high peak period where nearly 2 million people are visiting the island. And during the winter, we take 3 megawatt and we store them. The second step for Santorini is everything from city water desalination, cars, bus, trucks, to use the stored hydrogen. This application works already for the 2 years ago, started working in Paris, where they use taxis using hydrogen with not very high cost. Now, from the other side, if we see the right part of the slide, we have mainland Greece, and we take particularly the Evros area, which is also an energy hub. We can supply with energy, electric energy, as much as connecting with the grid, the national network for Greece, right? And then use liquid hydrogen for storage and then distribute it the way we said for the islands. Then we have to move to using hydrogen as a fuel, which gradually is going to substitute, replace LNG. At the same time, because this area is very rich in agricultural production, we can use the warm water for various applications. Tomatoes, asparagus, decorating fish. So can really help the agribusiness of the area using the zero cost hot water used in the geothermal application. Now, let me talk a little bit about the drilling. Next slide, dealing with the drilling. The drilling methods have taken and copied from the offshore deep drilling for gas. And since I work as a consultant for more than 10 international oil and gas companies, we know we have standardized the method. The diameter is 6.5 inches or 8.5 inches because we make it according to the commercial. So we don't want standards, whatever drills exist in the market. And to this one, We're using another area in order to minimize the time concern. We use a high store recovery method. That means we use chemically active surfactants, alkaline surfactants, and polymers in order to reduce to the minimum the time of drilling as well as the cost of the drilling. In certain cases, if you have an island, you can also apply directional drilling if you cannot do it vertically. Now, having the full lithology of the drilling, we are can achieve high costs. And definitely, at this moment, if somebody talking a cost, and most of the people in this conference are from energy economics, we're talking about the United States in California. We have started 3 years ago, I say we because I'm involved in various projects, with $7 per kilogram of hydrogen. And now the aim, particularly in California, which is really based a lot, or in Turkey from the other side, or in Croatia, they have three areas, two are neighboring, to bring it down to $3 or $2 per kilogram. Now, of course, with the high price of oil, what I'm saying now, it's much more competitive. So, now, the idea is that a lot of people, when we talk about hydrogen or we talk about geothermal energy, because both of them are brand new technologies, I mean, the deep drilling technology has started being improved after year 2015, right? And the hydrogen 2 years ago. Now, the pioneers in that have been in Reykjavik, Iceland, where they do it in 1930. But now, the largest units are the geysers project. This is like the one I propose. We don't make one drilling, but a set of drillings. And now we produce nearly 1,000 megawatts in California. Similarly, we have other locations like Croatia and Turkey. And Turkey is aiming with a plan for geothermal energy as well for hydrogen to reach to a percentage of 10% of the whole energy used in Turkey by year 2015. Of course, now in Afyon Karahisar, in Afyon, they try to also store energy via hydrogen. And of course, the first ones, world leaders in the area, is New Zealand, where the Mokai plant is started working 6 months ago, but represents the best way of application, producing energy via geothermal energy, also storing hydrogen to store it or to use it in other uses. Now, what are these benefits? Let's break the benefits, talking with engineering case study, in two different legs. The one is for islands. People who want to introduce the other two sister technologies, like wind or solar, require space, and sometimes the so-called, by people of the islands, white trees, the long trees, do not really add that much to the aesthetic quality of the islands. The geothermal energy, they are very nice, clean. We circulate the water, so we don't disturb the environment. For Santorini, from November to March, we have a population of 20,000 people. So this is the period where, using geothermal energy, you have to store it for, like we say in English, the rainy days. We have to store it for the sunny days, right? In summer, when the tourists are coming. At the same time, all applications in hotels, air conditioning, transportation, trucks, even boats can use liquid hydrogen. That's why the capacity of this unit we describe can reach capacity to 100 megawatts. And I do understand that this follows 100% zero carbon footprint. We don't have any carbon used. So by this, we can add to island, to Thira, to Santorini. Next slide, please. We can really add an element, right, that apart from the beauty and the beautiful sunsets, and can have 100% green island. Of course, we have also to turn to either electric cars or hydrogen moved cars. In both cases, we have 100% Greek island. Now, Evros River is a different case, and I did 20 years ago, 10 years ago, certain applications. By that time, we had legal problems. Who owns the whatever is under the, we had a law in the past, 20 years ago, that energy under the surface is a monopoly of the public power corporation. Now, this can develop as a moving arm, accelerating the development of Western Thrace, giving low-cost energy per kilowatt hour to the area, either to the area or to the national grid. And also give hydrogen can be used either by storage, like we use LNG, or for the near-rate future, for the future, can be used as hydrogen using the network of pipelines in the entire area of continental Greece. I also underline the fact that this area, it's an agricultural area, so can really go to high-quality organic products by using the heat coming from Earth, from Mother Earth. Now, recently, we have people, a lot of people are moving, right? And I think that this is, that we have now the first Scania has developed and subsidized in Sweden a steel factory only on hydrogen. BMW has announced they're going to use this energy, hydrogen energy, for cars, and a lot of people try to move also to what we call metal melting. So you understand at the end is the geothermal applications. If we see, yes, this one has the first element is drilling, which is very innovative, and we somehow we borrow the technology for oil and gas drilling, particularly gas drilling. PM electrolysis is really easy to go, and this is another method where we can work out the membranes, right? Because we talk about polymer membranes. Hydrogen production has started already, and hydrogen distribution can really offer to Greece a very as a strong tool for the green transformation of both islands and continental Greece. I think. Thank you for your attention, and I hope that you have enjoyed my presentation. Thank you very much.
We really thank you, Mr. Kanellopoulos, Professor Kanellopoulos, for your interesting presentation. It was a wonderful bridge between the previous session with ours about islands. I think we can have a talk at the end of our presentations if you agree with me. Anyway, I would like to answer to me later why you choose islands and not the mainland of Greece, because I think that the mainland has many geothermal sites that we can use this energy.
But I did both. Smaller size for the islands and large size for Evros, Nestos, and Strymon sedimentary basins. Okay. We follow the work done by IGME, and now we go, and IGME was talking, that's some test drilling, since you had the kindness to ask this question, but their technology in Greece, I'm very familiar with drilling in Greece, was going up to 200 meters or 300 meters. Now we talk about 10 kilometers. That means instead of looking for 60 degrees, we go for 200 degrees. Hot water coming up. And we put a twin. When I say twin, we put two drillings. We circulate the water. So we have very low cost production of electric energy. A part of that is turned to hydrogen. Continental Greece is more important, right? Because continental Greece requires cheap energy. For instance, now, the people who are in agribusiness with greenhouses, they have to pay a fortune for natural gas to heat them up.
Okay, thank you very much again for your presentation. And I call now Mrs. Gika, that she is back, I think. And Mrs. Gika, okay, you can have now your presentation. entitled Climate Change Adaptation Measures and Strategies for Electric Green Resilience Engagement, Impact Assessment and Lessons Learned from the Recent Extreme Weather Event Media.
Okay, I have read my screen. I don't know if you can see it. Sorry, can you see my screen?
Yes, it's okay, but you have to make full presentation if you want. Yes.
All right. So
we can't see your presentation now. Yes, it's okay. You can begin.
Okay. So we were going to discuss today the impacts of the extreme weather event Midea on the national power distribution grid and propose adaptation measures to enhance grid resilience against climate threats. My talk will be divided into four parts. First, a short introduction regarding the challenges facing today grid operators. Then the trajectory of Midea and the management strategy adopted by HEDNO. And from the above analysis, we will highlight strong and weak points in the response operations and identify contributing factors to grid vulnerability. And finally, we will discuss about the need for grid resilience and specific policies to achieve it. So, to begin with, the new era brings multiple challenges for electric power utilities, such as fundamental changes in structure and operation of the distribution grids as a result of renewable energy penetration and immobility. This new landscape will imply broader responsibilities and leadership role for utilities. We have also to mention the increased costs that grid operators will have to bear in order to maintain the AIDS grid infrastructure. A rather upraised issue is the large liability losses due to extensive damage to network equipment as a result of the new emerging risks. To make matters worse, climate change is expected to severely affect the entire energy supply chain as the extreme weather phenomena become even more frequent and seem to dominate in the new era. Of course, all the above should be considered in the context of the COVID pandemic that causes additional disruption in the entire grid operation. Climate change is nowadays by far one of the biggest challenges. According to the Global Risk Landscape 2021 of published by World Economic Forum, extreme weather is considered as the most likely global risk, while climate action failure stands out as the second most impactful and likely long-term risk. While electric power systems have achieved high degree of reliability under normal operating conditions and in the case of common failures, nonetheless, they are not able to effectively handle unpredictable situations caused by high impact and low probability incidents, such as the extreme weather phenomena. Unfortunately, most grid operators remain unprepared to handle such operational stress imposed as a result of climate change. And in this context, grid resilience is the key in order to manage and mitigate climate change. Let's see now how the extreme cold invasion Midea affected national power grid. According to the Hellenic Meteorological Service, Midea was the heaviest snowfall in the last 40 years in Greece. The snowfall triggered power and water supply cuts, serious transport disruption, while many regions faced emergency situations. Two factors have contributed to this direction. First, the higher temperatures during the snowfall that led to greater water content in snowflakes and therefore a much higher weight per surface unit. And second, the wind velocity that was much lower in Midea compared to the previous snowstorms, and as a result, wet snow could not be easily swept away by the winds on the ground. We can see here how the extreme weather phenomena, snow and wind, caused issues like falls of branches and trees on the power distribution lines, grid transformers and utility poles, thus resulting in extensive power outages. The mostly affected areas were Attica, Chalkida, and Volos. To open roads, prune trees, and restore damages, had no technical crews and partner contractors, worked under very difficult conditions and supported by workforce provided by the municipalities, the fire service, civil protection, and the army. A significant number of technical staff remained on standby duty for ad hoc contribution. As we can see in the graph on the right, 26% of own staff and 93% of contracted technical staff were further required to work on site in the Attica region. All other regions supported operations with workforce and means. In this light, we can see all actions taken by HEDNO in per phase of the disaster management cycle, starting from prevention, actions taken in advance, preparedness arrangements, response to effectively handle the emergency situation, and finally recovery after the evolution of the event. Here we can see the typical sequence of events following a power cut until the electrification of the end user. The fault is announced in HEDNO's call center and technical staff plans the prioritization of failures. Once access to the site is possible, the site is clear, and then electric restoration becomes possible. In this slide, we present the three key factors that determined the effective grid restoration under the exigent circumstances created by MEDEA. First of all, the coordination of response that was achieved through the division of Northern Attica into 9 zones. Second, the distribution dispatch control center in Attica that played a crucial role in resolving issues in the medium voltage network and guiding technical crews. Last but not least, the mesh structure of the Attica network. This means a topology including multiple connections between medium voltage lines and substations facilitated the immediate change of the power flow direction in case of a failure. Let us highlight now the strong points in HEDNO's response operations. Experienced technical crews, maintenance of backup staff, prioritization of restorations are only some of them. It's worth mentioning here that the technical crews that worked on site complied with all safety guidelines, and as a result, no accident was recorded despite the live line work. Further to the above and regarding infrastructure, the use of SCADA and drone in the Attica area facilitated grid inspection and fault location. We have to mention also the continuous presence of a shift of employees in the civil protection offices, which contributed significantly to the coordination of services. On the other hand, as in every crisis, MEDEA brought to the surface weaknesses in processes and mechanisms that need to be enhanced. Improper vegetation management in combination with overhead distribution lines has emerged as the key contributor to the extensive network damages. It should be noted here that more than half of the tree falls were caused by trees located on the other side of the road from HEDNO's network, a finding that should be considered for the implementation of future network development studies. Let us not overlook in any case, the fact that HEDNO faced MEDEA together with the COVID pandemic, so it should be considered as a crisis within a crisis. Our analysis results in the determination of critical factors that influence electric grid vulnerability, as well as responsiveness after an extreme event. These include, as we can see, vegetation management, urban planning, workforce efficiency and expertise, network configuration, reliability of grid infrastructure, availability of innovative technology solutions, an effective call center, supply chain management, standard operating procedures for emergency management, integrated approach for restorations, up-to-date technical documentation, a lessons learned database, cooperation with third parties, and legislative and regulatory framework. Taking the above into account, we conclude that grid resilience is of paramount importance to mitigate impacts of climate change on network infrastructure and system operation. Key attributes of a resilient power system include, as we can see, anticipation to avoid downtime, absorption of disruptions, recovery capacity, and adaptability to changing conditions. And here we can see the adaptation measures, policies, and strategies that are grouped in four main categories and include operational measures to upgrade business operations, smart measures to reinforce the intelligent operation of the distribution grid, network hardening measures, and cooperative measures with public authorities and the scientific community. Of course, the government will need to support such efforts in order to mitigate the effects of extreme weather events on the electric grid and ensure electricity insecurity. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Mrs. Gika. It was really interesting because the effects of media, I think everyone in the Attica region feel it, and unfortunately I was from those that was without electricity for 2 days. And of course, COVID crisis, it was something that make the problem more crucial. I want to believe that your strategy is a plan that the government has to follow in order to avoid situations like that in the future, because as we know, due to climate change, extreme weather event will be more often. So we have to be prepared. Okay, thank you very much for your presence. And now we can go on with Enrico Toseletti, who is the presenter of the third work entitled Assessment of an Existing Gas Pipeline to be Retrofitted to Hydrogen Transport Material Evaluations. A work written by Mr. Alessandro Terenzi, Enrico Toseletti, Daniele Scarciafare, Domenico Tomasini. Mr. Toseletti, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Dimitra. Thank you very much. Just a small introduction. I'm working for a company that is called Saipem, that is a contractor for onshore and offshore projects for oil and gas, and now also for the green economy. And I've been working more than 30 years, and I hope other 10 to come. As a designer, as material procurement, welding, and controlling the wells, and installing both onshore and offshore pipelines. And this presentation is dealing with the, let's say, transportation of hydrogen through pipelines. There were quite a few discussions before about the use of hydrogen. It needs to be transported, of course, and the pipelines are the standard, let's say, the natural way of transporting it. A lot of onshore pipelines have been constructed in the last 50 years and operated to transport natural gas. So being the environment very important for the next year, for the next future, for the humanity, we are thinking, and everybody is thinking all over Europe and all over the world as well, to transport, to retrofit existing gas pipeline to transport hydrogen. So what we are going to discuss is basically what are the issues in transporting hydrogen gas with existing gas pipelines. As a general, just to make a brief introduction to what is the status, there are a lot of studies and also studying the transportation of hydrogen through pipelines. And they started quite a few years ago, more than 10. And a lot of things have been written and a lot of roads have been run through these studies. In particular, there is a dedicated standard, an ASME standard, ASME B3112, that now is at the second 19 edition, and that is applicable for designing and for transporting, let's say, hydrogen gas for percentages that are mixed in natural gas with hydrogen percentages larger than 10%. Then there are studies and international university and companies studying, like Sandia, EIGA, SINTEF, and of course also the European Pipeline Research Group Council that is addressing studies and work on this. There should be a new standard soon on the market from UK, the IGEM TD1 Revision 6, dedicated with an appendix to hydrogen. And of course, some nominated researchers like San Marchi, Briotte, Michler, Holbrook, that have been testing and analyzing the problem. There are also few pipelines, few kilometers, I mean, some thousands kilometers of pipeline in the world transporting hydrogen already for local use, for specific use. We have to say that most of them have grades lower or equal maximum to X60, mostly are X52 or lower. Lower grades means less affected material, less affected by hydrogen embrittlement. We will see later. Also, we have to say that those pipelines were built with specific requirements to transport hydrogen. While now we are discussing the use of old existing pipelines transporting natural gas to transport hydrogen blend. Another thing that is quite important is that all these pipelines are onshore. So we are discussing onshore pipelines. The onshore pipelines are mainly affected by internal pressure, so the hoop stress, the circumferential stress. I talk about the B3112. B3112 has two main options. One is don't do anything, just use a higher safety factor if you want to transport hydrogen. So if you want to use old pipelines, you have to lower down the pressure. Or otherwise, you have to enter structural verification, the option B, where there are specific failure modes to be addressed, like fatigue and fracture. So speaking about failure modes, we are speaking about hydrogen effects on the steel material, on the carbon steel material. So we are speaking about hydrogen embrittlement. You see on the right that the hydrogen embrittlement is affected by the applied stresses, by the percentage and pressure of hydrogen, the environmental, and by material susceptibility. The three of them causes hydrogen embrittlement. So let's look at the failure mode just very quickly. We will discuss fracture and fatigue in this presentation, but of course there are other failure modes that can be affected. But for now we'll discuss fracture and fatigue as per ASME B3112, option B. Fracture and fatigue means engineering fracture mechanics assessment. So we enter with the loads, we enter with the flow size that are present on the wells mainly, but also on the base material and pipe material. We enter with the material characterization to the environment in order to check if it is critical or if we can inject, how much we can inject of hydrogen. Fracture mechanics means some approaches to be applied. And there are existing approach. So starting for ASME, ASME B3112, the reference is done to ASME 8 Division 3, and therefore to API 579 or to BS7910. BS7910 is the one of the standards applied for fracture mechanics evaluation for pipeline, together with DNV RPF 108. And this is the standards that we normally use for pipeline design. Let's speak about the circumferential stress and the loading for the hoop stress. As I said, ASME B3112 allows you two options. Option A means that you are using now for gas pipeline a certain pressure level and a hoop stress. You can use hydrogen, but you have to downrate the pressure to a level that is lower the stress. Why the stress should be lower? You see on the yellow. If the stress is lower, then the cross between the other circle is not there. So you don't have hydrogen embrisment. Or on the other side, you leave the pressure as it is, but then the cross will be there and you have to evaluate fatigue and fracture. This is for the hoop stress. But we have also longitudinal stress in the pipeline. You know, offshore pipelines are mainly buried. So you probably walk over them and you don't know. But there are some signals that tell you there is a pipeline under your feet. And when they are buried, most of the pipeline length, most of the pipeline route is, let's say, bounded. It's bounded and the stresses applied are very low. Almost less than, definitely less than 50% of the hoop stress. So, and also there is a temperature effect that increase the compression. So basically in various section, but means in the restrained area, this area. So actually the stress there are low. But something happens when you reach a curve, a bend, a situation where you cross roads, you cross rivers or something like that, or you reach the compression station or you get out from the compression station. Then there is a bend, and on the bend, the restraining is not as effective, as fully as in the other area. So the tensile stress longitudinal are increasing due to the pressure and the temperature, and due to the less counteracting effect of the soil. And the stress can reach values that can be 60, 70, up to 190, or even 100% of the SMYS. SMYS is the minimum specified yield strength of the material. So you are near the limit. Offshore, you have other issues, but let's not discuss for that right now. Speaking about material, the material susceptibility normally is tested through mechanical testing. You have to test fracture resistance through the stress intensity factor of the material, testing in the environment, so in hydrogen gas. Old pipelines cannot be tested so easily because they are already built, because they are old, and because you don't have tested any test in hydrogen. So what you can do? You can calculate the in-air fracture toughness starting from the char PV energy, from the impact test energy. This is a very conservative approach. Use the master curve. And you will see that if you use the master curve, you will get value in air, not in hydrogen, in air, of stress intensity factor of the material at maximum around 80, 60, 70 megapascal per square meter. Square root of meter. This means that you are honestly over the minimum requirement of ASME B3112, that is 55, but very near to that, a very low value in air. But then there is the effect of hydrogen. A lot of researchers have been doing testing, some Marchi, Briotte, and others, and they have, let's say, different indications. Some say that very small quantity of hydrogen reduces the fracture toughness down to 10 to 10th of the original air value. Some others say no, really no, but there is an effect of pressure, hydrogen partial pressure. And you can see in this slide, for instance, these two curves, here you have the hydrogen pressure. You know that onshore pipelines gets pressure up to 70, 80 bars. If you have 10% of hydrogen injected, meaning 7 bars of hydrogen, and you have X60 material, the reduction is not as much. If you have X70 material, they are typical grades for onshore pipelines, then you can have up to 30% reduction. So you can reduce to 70% of the original in-air value. So much low, you can be lower than the 55 we discussed before. If you go full pressure, you can even be lower. Now, when we speak about fracture and pipelines and welding, longitudinal welding, we speak about stress intensificator, stress intensification factors, stress concentration factors, because the geometry of the welds. And this stress intensification factor play a big role in the stress value. If we look at the application of the fracture mechanics approach, let's look at the right, at the left side of the slide. Using a low, very low CTOD, so 0.1 millimeter is something like 110, 120K. While CTOD of 0.025 is as low as 30 megapascal per meter. So if we are in the range of the minimum required of ASME B3112, that is the green curve, this green curve, you see that the height of the defect acceptable versus the length of the defect is not extremely high. We are around 1 to 2 millimeter height. And the actual indication accepted in the longitudinal welds are in that order of magnitude. So basically, we find that defect there. Meaning, can we afford to inject hydrogen? Of course, we can if the defect size allowed is larger. So in this approach, A big role is played by the residual stresses. A lot of people say that the residual stresses after 40 years operation are not anymore there. It has to be verified. I agree with most of the sentence, apart zero, that is not probably possible. Here you see the effect on the right side of the residual stress. If we simply neglect the residual stress, we go from this green curve to the blue curve on the other side, much higher defect size allowed. If we assume something like, I show you here, something like 100 megapascal, 150 megapascal, or 200 megapascal in residual stresses, the allowable flow size reduces. So it's important also to evaluate the residual stresses. Let's look now at the circumferential welds. The circumferential welds, we saw, they can reach a load up to 90 or 100% of the SMYS. If we are at 60% of the SMYS, like the curves on the left side, we see the acceptable flow size for a reasonable fracture toughness, that is a CTOD of 0.1 millimeter, the green curve, we can accept quite large flow size. So we can inject hydrogen probably. If instead we go to 90% of the SMYS with the same CTOD, with the same fracture toughness, you see the green curve is now getting lower than it was before. And the acceptable defect size in the original wells were larger than that. So we have to take care of this, and we have to analyze carefully what is the status of stress and material behavior. Again, also here, the residual stress play a big role. If the residual stresses are in a way included in the analysis for 90% or not included, of course, here in the right side is included, in the left side is not included, you see that the acceptable flow size are increasing without the residual stress inclusion. But again, we need to study it and to test it probably. What is the effect of hydrogen in the fatigue? fatigue is a big issue, yes and not for offshore pipeline, for onshore pipelines. There are studies on fatigue, not down factor for the constant, for the crack grow constant. The one existing very, very deep study was based on X42 grades. I told you that hydrogen was transported with low grade till now. So X42 grade is a very low grade, of course. And this curve you see here shows the ratio between the fracture toughness in hydrogen with respect to air. So in particular, if you have, let's say, 80 bar pressure in hydrogen, you have to use a knockdown factor with standard fatigue crack grow constant for Paris equation of about 30 or 40. If you have 6 or 7 bars of pressure of hydrogen, then you can cope with 10 to 15 a knockdown factor. There are a lot of data as well. And there are standards now telling us how to make fatigue calculation. One is ASME, ASME B3112, and another one is IGEM. They plot different constant at different curves, elasticity factor range and the fatigue crack growth for cycles. I think the most conservative is the IGEM, and the ASME B3112 is the yellow curve you see on this. While the standard approach for gas is the gray curve you see here. You see this gray curve. So hydrogen makes fatigue a larger issue, a heavier issue. We did some analysis starting from measurements on existing pipeline, more than 20 years measurements of pressure and temperature, making statistical analysis through and cycle counting through rainflow methods. We did calculate the cycles, the applied cycles for 20 years of operation. And we tried to make some analysis. In this graph, you see the flow rate and the year starting from the beginning of the pipeline operation. 1990 is the beginning. And you see this curve, the blue, this curve up to the 2020, let's say up to this year, 2021, has been operated with gas. So an initial flow size, 3.4 millimeter high, operated with gas, was simply not growing under fatigue. Very small crack growth. If we start to operate it with hydrogen using the, let's say, a factor of 40, we discussed before in the crack growth due to high pressure, let's say 70 bar, so full pressure, full percentage of hydrogen, 100% hydrogen, in the same pipelines, we will expect a crack growth, but not, not as much, because from 3.4 to 4 in how many years? 10, 20, 30 years. So it's not as much. So basically, it seems not to be a big issue, but there is an issue. And you can see it here. In this curve, in these plots, you can see what is the defect height versus the defect length for a longitudinal surface flow in a weld, in a longitudinal seam weld. The upper curve is the critical value we calculated before with fracture mechanics. Then the curves that are down, you see, is the crack growth after, let's say, 20, here is 30 years of operation with hydrogen. Here is 20, here is 10, starting from tomorrow. And here is what you get for the last 30 years operating in natural gas. No crack growth. But then there is some growth. So you have to consider that. The same. Sorry,
Mr. Torsoletti, you have to complete your presentation. You are out of time.
Yes. Okay. All right. The first presenter got 35 minutes. But okay, this is fine. It's right after the conclusion. So what I want to say is just if we go to girth weld instead, and we use 60% of the SMYS, the fatigue issue is larger because also temperature gets to play. And if we want to get, of course, to 90%, it's even worse. So we need, and I go only to one general conclusion. I can say that the effect of the percentage of hydrogen on both fracture toughness and fatigue growth was based on existing literature data. There, you have to test your material if possible, or otherwise you have to assume that from the literature data. The uncertainty is high, and dedicated tests are recommended again. In any case, we can say that actual grades of pipeline in use for natural gas transportation that are X60, X65, X70 in restrained area are fit for purpose, at least for 10% injection of hydrogen. If you get in unrestrained area, like bends, I discussed it before, then should not be a problem, but you need a specific analysis, a stress analysis to check if the stress is as high as 90% or 100%, because if it's 60, it's okay. Existing defects, if you run intelligent pigging, or if you can actually check manually because the pipe is there and you can walk over it, the existing defect, that welcome. The geometric characteristics have to be included. And the residual stress are very important together with the toughness test. So in case of small injection, not higher than 10%, hydrogen seems to be compatible with respect to failure modes analyzed. The same methodology I discussed here can be applied in general, also for larger percentage. And believe me, we need to do that before starting with transportation of hydrogen gas in pipelines. Thank you very much.
We really thank you for your interesting presentation about hydrogen transportation by pipelines. It's a crucial matter for Greece too, you know. And I think we can have a discussion later at the end of all the presentations. We have to go on with the presenter, Mr. Koutsandreas, who is the author also for the work accelerating the transformation of the Greek energy system through green hydrogen's penetration in the energy mix, a multi-criteria based power generation schedule, a work written by the presenter, Ioannis Papis, Georgios Trachanas, Alexandros Nikas, and Harry Dukas. Mr. Koutsandreas, we can have your presentation.
Yes, thank you, Mrs. Koubarou. My name is Diamantis Koutsandreas. I am a PhD student at the Decision Support System Laboratory at National Technical University of Athens. I am going to directly start. About the structure of this presentation, I will start by drawing the general context of the presentation and the research needs that it tries to cover and its main scope. Then I will present the main materials and methods used in this study. And finally, I will present the main results and conclusions, and I will give some suggestions about future work. So the severe repercussions of climate change make imperative the timely elimination of the anthropogenic greenhouse gases emissions. However, in order to achieve these targets, it is imperative that new clean technologies should be introduced, from which hydrogen currently is the most prominent one. Hydrogen presents the particularity that energy needs to be used in order to produce it. In that regard, its carbon emissions exclusively depend on the type of energy used for producing hydrogen. In that regard, two general categories can be identified. The one contains the green hydrogen, which is produced from electrolysis using only renewable energy. And so no emissions take place. While on the other hand, the other category contains the blue and green hydrogens, for which, in order to produce them, fossil fuels are utilized. Many challenges exist towards mainstreaming hydrogens, which are related mainly to infrastructure restrictions, differing country context, and the fact that many of the applications that are needed are still not commercially proven. However, the adoption of hydrogen could bring about significant benefits. First, it could stabilize the renewable energy productions through storage. thus reducing the curtailment in grids. And maybe the most important benefit, it has to do with the fact that it could help decarbonize hard to abate sectors where electricity is not an option. And also hydrogen enjoys a significant momentum, partly due to the increasing CO2 pricing. About the position of Greece in these scenes, Greece has pledged to achieve particularly ambitious targets, energy targets in the medium term, which entails that new clean technologies should come into play, like hydrogen. And also Greece presents a great technical potential of variable renewable electricity and subsequently of green hydrogen. Also, many initiatives have been established towards beginning the domestic hydrogen economy, from which maybe the proposal of White Dragon is the most emblematic one, since it is related to the West Macedonia, a place that has been connected to the delignitization of Greece. So, in order to formulate the appropriate policies that the transition to a free carbon economy demands, new aspects should be introduced on top of the currently used ones, from which focal should be the one of speed of actions. For example, at which speed a new clean fuel should come into play in order to meet a wide range of objectives. And also, a typical characteristic of designing energy policies is the fact that various stakeholders with divergent interests are involved in the respective procedure. Against this backdrop, the main objective of this study is to propose a methodological framework about how to evaluate power generation policy scenarios against various conflicting objectives and considering also the stakeholders' preferences, and by applying this methodology to understand how quickly new clean technologies should come into play. This is doing so by drawing from the case of green hydrogen penetration in the Greek energy system over 2030 to 2050. Here you can see the main methodological steps of the analysis. First, the reference scenario of the Greek energy system is developed, following some hydrogen policy scenarios are constructed, and finally, all the policy scenarios are evaluated against a number of conflicting criteria. In other words, a multi-criteria decision analysis is applied. All the policy scenarios are constructed with the Osmosis framework, which is a dynamic optimization model for long-run energy planning. And about the reference scenario, an implementation of the model is designed and calibrated to represent the idiosyncrasy of the Greek energy system over 2015 to 2050. To do so, we utilize the already undertaken targets and policy measures by the Greek government without any additional measures after 2030. Moreover, to the currently used energy technologies, new renewable technologies are introduced in the model for potential future employment like geothermal and wind offshore. On top of the reference scenario, three policy scenarios are constructed, which each of these entails a specific ratio of hydrogen penetration in the energy mix. In particular, the low penetration scenario presumes an amount of electricity that is coming from hydrogen or in the order of 5% of the final electricity demand, or about 10 petajoules, while the corresponding ratios for the medium and the high penetration policy scenarios are 10% and 15%. Moreover, while increasing the rate of hydrogens, we consider grid storage, an increasing rate of grid storage, since we model exclusively green hydrogen. So in order to ensure that the required renewable energy is available in order to produce the required amount of green hydrogen and also to cover the other needs of the energy system. The multi-criteria decision analysis is performed via the TOPSIS method. The main characteristics of these methods can be summarized to the fact that in order to identify the policy scenario of best prospects, it considers the distance from both the worst and best stays. Thus, it can be concluded that it is more appropriate for conservative decision makers. About the criteria of the analysis, they have been selected based on a literature review, and also they are synthesized in a hierarchical structure. In that regard, four family criteria are selected, where each family criterion contains one or more individual criteria, which serve as indicators for evaluating the family criteria. In particular, the environmental family criterion comprises the CO2 emissions. The economic criterion is composed of the capital investments and the variable and fixed operating cost. The energy criterion comprises energy dependency and the total capacity of the system. And finally, the social family criterion is consisted of the levelized cost of electricity. The preferences of the stakeholders are incorporated into the analysis via assigning weights to the criteria considered. While in order to evaluate the impact of these preferences, we perform a sensitivity analysis with respect to their variability. In that regard, 25 scenarios are constructed, where each scenario assumes a different mix of weights at the criteria of the analysis. Here you can see the scenarios and the criteria that corresponds to each scenario. About the results, here you can see the decision table. These numbers have been derived from the results from osmosis. This table is at the heart of multi-criteria decision analysis, since it illustrates the trade-offs that are taking place between the criteria. In other words, what amount of performance a decision maker accepts to sacrifice in order to gain additional performance from another criterion. And here it is illustrated the normalized performance of the policy scenarios per perspective considered. Here at this diagram, it is clearly shown the competitive nature of the criteria of the analysis. For example, the high penetration scenario, which entails the highest rate of hydrogen production, from the environmental perspective, it achieves the best performance in terms of CO2 emissions. However, this comes with a cost. So from the economic perspective, the high penetration policy scenario presents the lowest performance. Moreover, this diagram could be interpreted as we solve the problem as one criterion problem. So in this case, if we selected one particular perspective, then the best policy would be one particular policy, as they are shown here. However, in this study, we apply a multi-criteria decision analysis, so we consider all the criteria simultaneously. So here you can see the scores that the TOPSIS produces for the policies considered across all scenarios. As you can see, there is a significant variability across while the stakeholders' preferences are varied. So, however, between the policy scenarios considered, the medium penetration scenario, where the gray line illustrates this scenario. It presents the higher stability. You can see here that it is the more straight between the other. And for this reason, it achieves the best average score. On the contrary, stands the high penetration scenario, which since it has a very poor performance from the economic perspectives, when the economic criteria becomes the most preferred, this poly scenario presents very low scores. Here it is the same diagram. It shows the ranks that are derived from the scores presented before. As you can see, the medium penetration scenario presents, it is ranked at the majority of times at the first place, in particular at the 20 times from the 25 scenarios. So it can be concluded that it presents the higher stability across varying decision makers' preferences. Here you can see the energy mix of the reference scenario. Due to time limitations, I have not put the other energy mix of the other scenarios. Here, as you can see, from 2050's perspective, time perspective, only the natural gas remains in the energy mix, while renewable energy dominates the energy mix. And what happens at the other poly scenarios while increasing the rate of hydrogen is that the rate of natural gas decreases, and the gap created, it is mainly covered by wind and solar. So what can be concluded? First, due to the variability that the results presented, it can be concluded that power generation programming should be treated as a multi-criteria problem, and also that new innovative aspects like the speed of action should be considered when designing energy and climate policies. Moreover, maybe the most important conclusion is that an ad hoc analysis is required in order to decide about the policy scenario of best prospects, since the results are heavily dependent, as I presented before, on the stakeholders in question preferences. Moreover, green hydrogen can significantly accelerate the transition to a carbon-free Greek energy system at a relatively low economic cost. Also, as I said, the moderate penetration policy presents a higher stability. And finally, green hydrogen's penetration should be combined with the adoption of storage technologies to ensure the required amount of renewable energy. Some indications of future work related to this study: new aspects could be incorporated into the analysis, like the one of biodiversity. Moreover, the uncertainty could be modeled by considering many scenarios with respect to models parameters. Also, the osmosis could be linked with a macroeconomic model, and additional multi-criteria methods could be employed to inspect the results dependence on the method used. So that is all for me about this presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Kousandrea. I would like to ask you that this multi-criteria power generation program, you have tested for all the country, for Greece. Is this right?
Yes, it is for Greece.
Okay, can we have this program for a region, a specific region? Can we use it for a narrow area? Or it is only for countries?
Yes, this methodology could be applied to any geographical coalition. However, what creates a restriction is the model used, as I said before, the results based on the osmosis, which is which is a dynamic optimization model for energy programming. And the particularities of these models is that they have a focus or they are country-based. Mm-hmm. So, of course, if we could create many instances of this model for many countries, then we could apply this methodology for any country or any regional coalition. So from the multi-criteria perspective, there is no any regional restriction. The regional restriction comes from the model used, how you are going to model the energy system in question.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for your presentation. And now we go on with the presentation that I have to do with title Culture and Energy Transition. The authors are Mr. Zervas and me. I'm the presenter, of course. And as I share my presentation, I would like to tell you that I will try to see all these presentations that we have today, tonight, under through the glasses of a social science to want to make you understand what the social science reads when he is in communication like this. I think you can't see my presentation. Can you now? Okay, you can see it. Okay, my name is Dimitra Koubarou. I'm a postdoctoral researcher at the Hellenic Open University and especially at the Laboratory of Technology and Policy, Energy and Environment. My work is about culture and energy transition, and I would like to share with you the trigger for this work. This summer, I took part in an event about development transition in Greece, and the presenter mentioned natural and cultural environment, which has been degraded by mining activity and power generation, is a crucial factor both for the development of new activities as well as for the well-being of residents in the process of ending lignite dependence, defies, and telecommunication process. This quote conceals the social character of energy, even if the presenter didn't know that he was talking about energy culture and how many scientific terms of social sciences of energy were hidden in it. First, it refers to energy systems. And today we refer to energy systems. These are socio-technological systems that involve not only machines, pipes, mines, refineries, grids, but also persons and societies which design and make technologies, develop and manage routines, use and consume energy. All these shape economy, policy, social practices, norms, values, institutions, and a network of relationships among them. There is no energy without society and its infrastructure and function, without policy, economy, and social values. Second, this quote introduces the term energo power, that is, the interrelations of energy and political power. Politics is the constant companion of socio-technical transitions, serving alternately and often simultaneously as context, arena, obstacle, enabler, arbiter, and manager of replications. Politics and power are crucial factors to how different transition pathways are shaped, which pathway wins out, and why and who benefits from them. A genealogy of modern power that rethinks political power through the twin analytics of electricity and fuel makes the energy power. The quote introduces the term energy scape that illustrates how energy flows from one domain to the next and across boundaries of economy, culture, and politics. The term refers to current flows, the circulation of social, economic, and political relationships that emerge in the context of energy systems. Energy scape refers to cultural, social, economical, and technological values. All these terms are inside energy culture. What is energy culture? Energy culture describes the reasons for the choice of energy technologies in a location. Culture is a compilation involving a host of processes, reflecting a territorial perspective, resources, and history to shape how changes to technologies evolve to meet social and economic needs. The relationship between resources, technologies, and society affects the type of energy technologies, relations with firms, and the innovation systems of the countries. Energy culture is a multi-scalar concept and invites the exploration of subject or community's norms, practices, and material artifacts and how these influence each other. Energy culture is based on building the structure and access to energy provisions for the society. And this is the framework. The framework of energy culture, and there are three main building blocks that we have to consider. Energy culture framework provides a means to understand interlinked behaviors and efforts. The main three building blocks are material culture, cognitive forms, and energy practice. By material culture, we have to indicate if the community is fully or partially connected to electricity grid, has high or low resilience on lignite, it chooses an energy provider and an energy type, if there is high and low cost of electricity compared to incomes, there are old and new energy infrastructures, and if there is a little or much community outreach on energy systems. Cognitive norms point out the acceptance of renewables, the sense of responsibility to conserve energy, the individual agency, the quality of life, the environmental personal norms, the biocentric attitudes, and the anthropocentric attitudes. On the other hand, energy practice cites the awareness of energy use and cost, frugal consumption behaviors, energy consumption, further opportunities to conserve energy, conservation driven by financial motives, conservation driven by environmental motives, intentions to purchase energy efficient products. Why we talk about energy culture and why we need energy culture? We know that energy transitions do not occur simply because of the exhaustion or the abolition of old energy sources, and any solutions to the climate crisis of the 21st century will depend on people's perceptions of science, environment and risk, informed and shaped in turn by the media. Each attempt for transition requires multifaceted and comprehensive knowledge. This knowledge, however, must not be restricted to technological innovation or new market tools, but also involves the sociocultural basics of the production and use of energy in a given society, that is, the energy culture of the society. To design the mutual linking of energy, society, and culture in an innovative way, knowledge about conflict potentials and their negotiation, as well as the innovation of alternative forms of organization, practices, and integrative frameworks play a central role. The understanding of the local context through the attention to local communities' narratives and the social histories, identities, a lived experience of place is key to just transition. Substantial time and effort have to be dedicated to gain insight into how communities' organization of social life is in accordance with the mining activity. This knowledge will drive the way to future. Why we talk about energy culture? Energy culture interprets the choice of energy, technologies, and extends to how and why a country, a society, a region, a community innovate. innovation has to do with energy culture. A region, including energy resources, along with domestic and foreign political economic actions, influence geopolitics, expression of power, and choices around energy technologies. Geopolitics influence both geographic and political reasons for choosing energy resources and technologies. Society's perception of equitable access to energy services is expressed through energy justice. Energy justice is the vision of the European Union under the Just Transition Program, which influences the choice of technologies and the focus of innovation efforts and geopolitical expression of power. In other words, energy culture shapes the foundational structure of the state and domestic and international expressions of authority, including attempts to meet societal expectations of energy resources and services. How is connected energy culture and just transition? Embedded systems of knowledge, behaviors, beliefs, energy culture, that means, mobilize state and private resources within a geographic area through a process of intent to innovate new energy technologies and business platforms to improve security and practices benefiting society and the environment, achieving energy justice. Thank you for your attention, and please bear in mind that the greening of the societies demands first a transformation of behaviors, attitudes, values, and priorities, a new energy culture. Thank you. Thank you, and I want to believe that you find an interesting option of how a social scientist looks at the energy matters and the pipelines, at the new technologies and the innovation and the tools about transition.
Fine, Dimitra. I don't take the liberty in asking, sharing this nice cooperation. I think that I want to congratulate the organizers of this meeting. I want really to place one question to to Enrico, and then another question to Mr. José Andrés. But I start, since I'm familiar with the company you represent, and I think that you are, and from the other side, I want to share that I did a lot of consulting work for Fatigue in South Africa for propellers, construction, so I'm very familiar. Since Fatigue is a dangerous element in fracture mechanics, I belong to the South African School of Fracture Mechanics. So you understand that we know a lot. And my master's degree was on automatic welding. So I combine both, although I'm in brit materials. Now we have a case with Equinor, particularly the offshore piping, right, and transportation. We know that Equinor has two pipes, 900 kilometers each. And with methane, they have a problem of doing hydrates, etc. Now, of course, this makes your proposal much more attractive if the Norwegian guy makes the blue hydrogen, right, and carries hydrogen instead of, because in the North Sea, as you're aware, the sea is minus 20. So how can you see that? So I want to ask you, how do you see the potential for dynamic, problematic offshore transportation via pipelines?
Well, speaking about offshore, I work for the offshore section. And I can tell you, I can actually share one of the slides I jumped over. Because in that slide, if I don't remember bad, I don't know if you can see this, the slide.
No.
Let me share it. Yeah. I'm sharing. Eh? I don't know if it's possible. Oh, that one. Yeah. You see here. This is offshore.
Yeah.
Now, offshore normally is a large temperature because you have to compress and go long distance. This means lateral buckling. onshore, you don't have lateral buckling. Lateral buckling is what you see on the right, on the left,
yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Basically, increasing pressure, increasing temperature, the pipes goes compression, and at a certain point it wants to go lateral. So you have to design for that. And when you oscillates with the pressure and temperature, that bends will going to be coming back and going further, coming back and going further. So there is fatigue, definitely. And also the peak loading is important there. I don't see the sharing anymore. But, okay, could you share the slide? Thank you. On the right side instead, you see there is a free span, because when you lay on shore, you excavate a trench, you put the pipe in it, and you cover it. Fine. It's very well bounded. Offshore, you lay the pipe on the mountains. So you just go from one peak to the other, and you have free spans. You have vibration. So fatigue is an important issue. Allowable free span length is an important issue. I believe it's neglected right now, because the only standard that is existing is for onshore pipeline. DNVGL has started a new joint industry project, so I advertise them. We are sponsoring it. There are plenty of people sponsoring it, plenty of companies, where they should address these issues quite carefully. As well as going back to the low temperature. The low temperature could be an issue, yes, but we have already quite low temperature also with natural gas offshore. And being in deep water, if you get some water, you can get hydrates, you can get water condensation, you can get whatever. But of course, transporting hydrogen is more related to me to the brittle behavior of the material. And if you have to go offshore and inject something that doesn't degrade the energy you are transporting, you have to go full pressure, even larger probably. And if you go full pressure, you have to study very carefully and test very carefully your material. Now, using old pipelines is okay, but we need really some testing. And I believe at the moment onshore is not really like that. Politically, economically, and from the social point of view, there has been a very interesting presentation from the chairman. Seems like we don't see the time. It's time to inject hydrogen in pipelines. Fine, let's do it. But we should be a bit thinking on the steps to be done and not to be too fast and to discover after a while that we get issues. So offshore is a bigger issue. I believe it's a bigger issue. The thickness is larger, and therefore the hoop stress is lower, but the longitudinal stress is larger than in onshore. I don't know if it answered your question.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It was really straight to the point.
Yeah, thank you.
Now, my second question, if you allow me, Mr. Chairman, is goes to, we talk about Mr. Kouchandreou, and to talk a very nice thesis, actually. I have to confess that I'm doing that for the last 40 years, so I like to see a young PhD student to guide to share my ideas. We talk about Greek hydrogen, and you placed it very correctly, and I really like that other people share my ideas about the potential of Greek hydrogen. At the same time, as a professional, I do applied research and training, for instance, for an Italian company like Eni, right? Or Melita, how they call it, we want to try blue hydrogen, and and there is always a task, a philosophical task. If in Leviathan, Tamar, Zohr, or Aphrodite, to put floating units and get blue hydrogen, which can be used for Greece. So how do you see, the question is, the use, the matching of green hydrogen with imported blue hydrogen coming from offshore activities or natural gas in the Mediterranean?
Yes, thank you, Professor Kanellopoulos, for the question. I think the main question is the targets that need to be met. So if we are to reach carbon neutrality And then the only possibility to use blue hydrogen in the medium and in the long term, it is to use hedging technologies like carbon capture. So in this case, yes, it is an option. Otherwise, I think it is not possible since the targets that we have set, it is not possible to be met.
Yes, in this point, you know that there is a current progress financed by EU. We train when we produce blue hydrogen, you do carbon capture and storage, and we produce methanol. So this is again clean process, but it's combined. The floating production and storage unit has in parallel another unit catching the CO2 because we burn that. And logically, this means a floating unit can do that. Of course, you understand that the floating production and storage units are already in Greece, already in Alexandroupolis. So we think about a similar situation for blue hydrogen imported by Greece, which is the nearest destination, Italy and Greece, and get a mixture of green hydrogen and blue hydrogen. Of course, nowadays, blue hydrogen is too expensive because natural gas is too expensive. But we talk about the future.
Yes, I think this is a possibility, but the question here is if based on the high potential that Greece has to produce green hydrogen, since it has a great potential from renewable energy production perspective, if Greece can base only on green hydrogen, should adopt this strategy to import blue hydrogen? This is a question, I think.
Considering again... Sorry, I'm asking, but this is, I mean, the theme of a conference, right, to exchange points of views. The idea is, and I'm working as a consultant and trainer for more than 11 oil and gas companies, mainly in gas. This pays, we don't know how much is the price of a ton or equivalent ton of CO2. So those guys who have to pay a fortune for the methane or blue gas, we can invite them to Greece to invest the renewable energy. So these guys, because instead of paying a fee, $60, $70, $100 per equivalent ton, they invest their money and they take their money from one pocket and put it in the other. That's what I'm implying, right? So that's why Greece has a great potential for that.
Yes.
That's why I say the combination of blue and green hydrogen has to be, it's a pair, we couldn't do that. Because we have Tamar, we have Zohr, we have Aphrodite, we have Leviathan, and these guys have problems. They talk about Eastmed. I mean, which
yes,
is not.
But now the proposals that have been submitted to the European Commission have a very ambitious targets in terms of installed capacity, like the White Dragon that I presented before.
I agree with you. EU has a nice and aggressive policy, but EU or United States cannot control today the high price of, like Mr. Mytilineos, the who owns a company, say, like pricing oil, 7 euro per liter. Now, this is the prices of, and we expect to go higher, 700% of the last year price. So you understand, EU has to reconsider their policy. EU is based in a transition, but now, natural gas energy is very expensive. We always consider the prices of last year or the year before. But now we're running a large crisis on energy like the one in 73, a large crisis like the one in 2015. This is a third crisis, can be larger than those two energy crises. That's why I'm saying we have to grasp the location of Greece with the floating units can become importers or have joint forces with offshore natural gas production and become the best, the first in Europe, utilizing blue hydrogen. This is my point. You see?
Okay. I see your point.
Maybe the second.
Yeah.
No, joking.
I'm familiar with you, Enrico, with the pipeline 512 kilometers from Libya to that, and I have people who are working for that, right? That's why I'm familiar with your company, what you're doing, right?
Yeah, I understand that. Yes.
Although I'm an academic, from one hand, I'm also a consultant from the other, so I try to compromise those two things.
It's very good. It's very good.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very interesting also.
Yes. Yes.
And Mr. Kanellopoulos, you make an interesting suggestion to European Union about energy policy and who controls the prices of energy.
Since you are in social sciences, you see, there is always a conflict of interest between social scientists, politicians, and engineers, right? I'm an engineer, right? So I find a lot of work from politicians in the energy policy plan, right? And certain cases, sometimes I believe that the role of engineering projects, like the two people where I had the honor to share this session, is I find a lot of faults in EU policy. And since we're in public, I have to say, people, one of my first year master students who never approve a pipeline like EastMed.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Cannot approve this. This is, I mean, the prices. We have a record with us. 500 to 11 kilometers cost something like 8 billion. How much would cost 1,700 kilometers? The guy say 12. I mean, this is an arithmetic exercise, right? You laugh, right?
Yes, of course, because I think that we are in the opposite situation between engineering mechanics and politicians and social scientists. It's an old school of thinking. I think that we have an integrated knowledge. And if you check the presentation today, for example, Mr. Kouchandreas mentioned stakeholders' preferences. He also mentions at the multi-criteria family social multi-criteria. Is that right?
Yes, yes.
Mr. Trusseletti just a few minutes ago mentioned about social acceptance. And you, Professor Kanellopoulos, make a suggestion about energy policy in the European Union and about prices. All of this is about people, and people make society. So we are on the same boat, but we use different glasses. That's my point. And that's what I try to do as a social scientist in the energy sector, because I think engineering and economy is the main players in this sector. But you know, there is society and communities too. And the social acceptance of every change makes the future better. And if we want to combat the climate crisis, I think that we have to persuade people and to have a better life. The everydayness have to be better for everyone.
Dimitri, you're absolutely right, because I mean, the price of gas or the price of hydrogen or the people's attitude defines something we call it assertive. And mm-hmm. I quote Thales of Miletus, who say nothing is assertive. Mm-hmm. Nothing is assertive in nature. We have to study and find the main reasons making it. So all of us, social scientists, engineers, and of course economists who want to spend the money, right? So nothing is certain. Nothing is certain. And for your information, just to close this nice conversation, Thales, in 600 before Christ, he was a part-time astronomer, and studying the stars, he found that there will be an eclipse of sun 1 year ahead of time. He developed a fantastic irrigation system of hot water using thermal energy in the city of Sardis. We're talking about something that has taken place 6th century before Christ. And he is the developer of risk management. And as you are aware, risk management, particularly ferry analysis, is something he developed, the risk management theory, 600. Unfortunately, he didn't write anything. Oh, we didn't have writing that period, right?
Yes.
So I say nothing is assertive. People's attitude, engineering problems, and as well, the new means for substituting fossil fuels. Mm-hmm. But it was very interesting and very nice. I also congratulate the committee because all these presentations in this session were matching like each other, like one following up the other.
Yes, it was integration knowledge, I want to believe.
Yes, yes.
Thank you for your participation.
And thank you, Dimitri.
I wish you a nice evening.
Well, you too, you too all. Thank you to everybody. Very interesting conversation. Probably the most interesting conversation of the day, I would say.
Look, this is, again, I go back to classic. This is the Socratic method. Socrates was writing something that raised questions.
There was good. That's good.
This is the Socratic method. Midwifery method, right?
And philosophy too. Okay. Have a nice evening.
Thank you. Have a nice evening and a nice lunch. Dinner. Bye-bye.
Good night.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.